Moses, Rabatino Hasrat, Sabsi Pele, mein Ab, Lugunka, Boho, Boho, Chukria, Adakana, Chachtio, Ki Abne, Moji, Yaha Bulalia, O Yaha Abki Sami Lecture, Pishkanika Moka Didia, Or Ye Merilie Bari Hoshi Gibarhe, Kyunki, Me Takriban Ti Sal Bad, Hyderabad Aihu, Me Pehli Bad, Sanuniso Tirasi Me Aiti, Or Abto, Jab Me Aitu, Deka Kesarhe, Ki Boho Badla Hua Paya Sherko. मैं कल रात को ही पहुंची लेकिन कल खूब शहर देखने के लिए सैर करने के लिए शहर जाऊंगी भी जरूर मैं आपसे इजाजत चाहूंगी कि अपना मकाला अंग्रेजी में पेश करूं क्योंकि वो अंग्रेजी में लिखा गया और अगर आप बाद में उर्दू में सवाल पूछना चाहें तो खुशी से पूछिए आप मर्जी से अंग्रेजी हिंदी या उर्दू में पूछ सकते हैं लेकिन अब फिलहाल तो आप मैं मुआज़रा चाहती हूँ कि अपना मकाला अंग्रेज़ी में पेश करूँगी और अपने कुछ वैसे ख्याल ही अंग्रेज़ी में पेश करूँगी क्योंकि शुरू तो मैं करूँगी इसी मौजू से इकबाल और जर्मनी वैसे मुझे तो पूरा यकीन है कि आप लोगों ने इस बारे में बहुत कुछ सुना और पढ़ा होगा क्योंकि इकबाल के बारे में तो सैकड़ों किताबें मौजूद हैं बहुत कुछ लिखा जा चुका है बहुत सारी सेमिनार्स हुई हैं और जाहिर है कि अलमगी शिमर का नाम सबको मालूम होगा जो हमारी जर्मनी की सबसे बड़ी मुहक्किक थी इकबालियात के सिलसिले में और बहुत सारे दूसरे शोबों में भी So now I will continue in English. So, of course, she is known for her translations of Iqbal's works into German and also for her very good book and deep study, Gabriel's Wing, and many other articles in collections which were published in India and Pakistan and some also in the West. So this was the older generation of people studying Iqbal and translating Iqbal and introducing Iqbal to the West. Of course, there are many other names, but I will concentrate on the German contribution or German language contribution because there was one other gentleman who was very active in introducing Iqbal to the West, Christoph Bürgel of Switzerland. He also translated works of Iqbal into German and wrote a number of learned articles on Iqbal. So, but these were the people of the older generation. So what is the present situation as far as Iqbaliyat is concerned? So I have the impression that for a certain period, nothing much happened in between. After these great scholars, Annemarie Schimmel and Christoph Bürgel were no longer there. But now of late, a new generation of people has come up and a new interest in Iqbal has developed. We have two people who have worked on Iqbal recently, one young scholar with a background in Persian studies. He wrote a book for the general public in German language about Iqbal's engagement with the West and especially his philosophical thinking. So this was really meant not for academia, but for a general public. I think this was the first attempt, really, to bring him, get him to the German public. And on the more scholarly plane, another young scholar engaged in translations of several of Iqbal's writings, also his English prose writings into German language, which have partly been published by the Iqbal Academy in Pakistan, but which are available in Germany. And the same scholar whom I already mentioned, he wrote his PhD thesis on the, one can say, poetics of Iqbal Shariat, but on a very modern theoretical methodological basis. And this is a PhD thesis which has been published in English. It is called Muhammad Iqbal's Romanticism of Power. So, and then recently another work has been published, another PhD, interestingly written by a young scholar with an, as far as I remember, Iranian background, but written in German language at a German university and also published in Germany about Iqbal and the West, especially his more his poetic engagement with the West based on the Persian poetry, not the Urdu poetry. So these are the youngest, the latest developments in Iqbaliyat in Germany. I have been engaged with reading and studying Iqbal since my student days, and the last, one can say, the latest link in this series was a conference we organized at our university, Heidelberg University, in 2007 to commemorate Iqbal's stay in Heidelberg in 1907. And the proceedings are also published. Of course, everybody here will know that Iqbal spent some time in Germany, in Munich, and then 6 months in Heidelberg, and he really loved the city. And I am at Heidelberg University at present, so we have a very close link, of course, to Iqbal and to his memory, and there are several places dedicated to his memory in Heidelberg. And whenever there's any special occasion in connection with Iqbal's life, so we have small commemorative sessions, seminars, and articles are published in the newspapers, etc. So he's very much alive in the memory of the city. During his stay in Heidelberg, he spent much of his time reading the poet Goethe. This again is a subject which has been discussed in many publications, and there's, I think, a very thick volume, Iqbal and Goethe, which was published by Ikram Chagatai in Pakistan. So I will not talk about this relation in general terms, but just about very specific poems by Goethe and Iqbal. Suffice it to say that Iqbal probably had studied Goethe first in English translation when he was in Great Britain or even before, but when he came to Germany, he tried to read the German original, and he was, of course, helped by that by his German tutor, Emma Wegenast, with whom he developed a very close relationship, a very friendly relationship, and they exchanged letters for quite some time afterwards, first in German language and then in English. So Iqbal has mentioned several times how deeply he was by Goethe, and he considered him to be one of the greatest philosophers or seers. He has mentioned him several times in his poetry, but also in his stray reflections. And this is of course also reflected in the fact that he dedicated his very important Persian collection of poetry, Bayame Mashrik, as a response to Goethe's West-Östlicher Divan, West-Eastern Divan. So the poem I'm going to discuss here now is a part of this collection, Bayame Mashrik. But the poem which he took for this collection was not a part of Goethe's West-Östlicher Divan. It is a poem which was written by Goethe much earlier. In the West-Östliche Divan is one of the latest products of Goethe. It was written at quite an advanced age, in his mature phase, you can say. Whereas the poem Iqbal chose for the adaptation is a very youthful poem written between 1772 and 73. So much, much earlier than the West-Eastern Divan. And this is the poem, the text you have before you, and the photocopies. So, I would just like to read out a few lines, and I wanted you to have the copies also to have a visual impression of the text. When you look at the text, you will see the structure. I mean, it's very obvious how the poem is structured. And I will just read out a few lines to give you an idea of the sound of the German original. Seht den Felsenquell, Freude hell, wie ein Sternenblick über Wolken, nährten seine Jugend gute Geister zwischen Klippen im Gebüsch. Jünglingsfrisch tanzt er aus der Wolke auf die Marmorfelsen nieder, jauchzet wieder nach dem Himmel. Durch die Gipfelgänge jagt er bunten Kieseln nach und mit frühem Führertritt reißt er seine Bruderquellen mit sich fort. Drunten werden in dem Tal unter seinem Fußtritt Blumen und die Wiese lebt von seinem Hauch. So, when one looks at Goethe's Westöstlicher Divan, you would see that the poems there are very much shaped on Persian models, on Hafiz, for instance. Goethe was greatly influenced and enchanted by Hafiz poetry, which had come to his knowledge then through translations. So he also tried to imitate the poetic forms. So it is a very classical, they have a very classical touch. When we look at this much earlier poem, I mean, this is completely irregular. It's as unclassical as can be. It is an eruption, one may say, of energy, of feeling, of enthusiasm, of dynamics, which is attained by Goethe through the choice of words, the sound of the words, the meaning of the words, and the structure of the lines and the stanzas. So, I mean, you can say it is a really complete union of content and form. And he has also created many new words. He has created many new compounds. He has a very unusual usage of words. So in many ways, it was a very revolutionary, radical poem at this time. And the public also welcomed it enthusiastically. It was, I mean, taken up as one of the greatest achievements of the time, literary achievements. So what's the background for that? And when you see it, it is called Mohammed's Gesang, which doesn't mean song by Mohammed, but it's an ode to Mohammed. And it was meant to be a drama, a part of a drama, and these stanzas were to be sung by Hazrat Ali and by Hazrat Fatima. So he could never complete the drama, and this is really what remains of it. He had probably composed some more parts, but they are lost, so this is all that remains. So why got he interested in this subject? I mean, what was the situation, the background for this poem? So there are many factors which contributed to Goethe's interest in Islam, and especially in this heroic character of the Prophet Muhammad. It was a time of political suppression in Germany. Germany was divided into small princely states, which were mostly very, very backward, very oppressive, economically, socially backward, lack of freedom. And the German language and German literature was still struggling to come into its own. So French language, French literature was very dominant, French culture was very dominant. So in many fields, there was urge, especially among the youth and among young writers and poets, to get out, to tear these fetters and to break free. And of course, then the heroic character and this successful movement, this dynamic movement of Islam, of early Islam, of course, was a wonderful model or wonderful vision to somehow express this wish to break something free, to create something new, to unite others, take others along and to create a huge and successful movement, dynamic movement. Another thing was that another factor which contributed to Goethe's interest was that he was a bit repelled by the negative picture created of the Prophet in other writings of the time. And he also wanted to counter this image. So this is also a reaction to a negative image. And of course, it was also an engagement with religion, because Goethe was not very secure, not very sure about his own belief system and about his own relation with Christianity and the Christian church. So he was also seeking. He was seeking for inspiration and for other modes of belief, etc. So all these factors combined to create this type of poem. And you will see that in other poems have a name of the name of the Prophet Muhammad or the mention of Islam in it. I mean, both of them can, of course, be interpreted also in more general ways for any dynamic movement which unites many forces and creates something completely new. And the only reference to the geographical location we find is in Goethe's use of words such as Atlas, the Atlas Mountains, or these trees, cedar trees, these trees which are the cedar trees which are famous, I mean, of Lebanon. So these are some hints at the location. But otherwise, there are no hints to the specific location and character. Now, when we look at Iqbal, you see there's a small Urdu footnote. Here, Iqbal himself calls it an Azad Tarjuma. I would not even call it a free translation, I would rather call it an adaptation, because it is so different. So you will find that the central idea is the same. We have the stream, and we have the stream advancing from very modest beginnings as a small mountain spring, and then growing and growing and developing more force, and also beginning to run more smoothly. And he has also translated some of the metaphors, some of the similes used by Goethe. But when you look at the structure, it is completely different. So as far as the structure of the poem is concerned, it is really at par with Goethe's Westöstlicher Divan. It has this klassikiert. No? It is in regular form, it has a refrain, and it runs much more smoothly. Also, the wording is not as revolutionary or radical. We have many, of course, we have a very strong influence of the Urdu and Persian Arabic, poetic tradition, yeah, many words, many similes and metaphors from the traditional, from the conventional Urdu and Persian poetry. So it somehow looks much more domesticated, one may say, than Goethe's poem. So how then does he at all, does Iqbal achieve the same sense of dynamism, of enthusiasm, exaltation as Goethe does? Of course, he tries to bring these elements in by the wording. For instance, when the mountain spring is still small, the wording is very sweet and soft. But then when it grows and develops more force, then you also get more aggressive wordings, words such as kashidan, daridan. And there's one word also which is very important, I think, that is the word mastana, so which comes up in the refrain. So here you have this madness or this intoxication, which is felt in Goethe's poem. It is here expressed not as much as by the poetics of the poem, but by this very word. Of course, we have the same ideas that this one seminal force then attracts many other minor forces and they unite with him. And also a very central idea to both poems, which is taken up by Goethe two times in the poem, that in the final consequence, in last consequence, of course, everybody is drawn by the creator, by the source, by the creator. So this is an idea common to both poems. Iqbal, of course, added something new. He specifically mentions East and West, which Goethe didn't feel need to do, but of course for him it was very important, because the whole work, Payame Mashriq, is in engagement with the West, with Western thinkers, poets, philosophers, etc. So this was, of course, very central for him. And what I also find, and of course he specifically stresses, more than Goethe, Iqbal stresses the creation, the overcoming, overruling of old things and creating of new things, new facts. But as I already mentioned, what I find very important is that both authors see the creator as the final destination. But how do the rivers, the rivulets, meet with the samundar, with the ocean? So they do not melt in the ocean. It is very interesting that Goethe says, you can look at the English translation, the waiting parent's bosom, in German, dem erwartenden Erzeuger. So I find this very interesting, because Goethe, Iqbal has often expressed this idea that the supreme ego, the ultimate ego, also wants to meet the individual ego. So both meet. It's not that the individual ego, the small hoodie, the individual human hoodie or ego melts or is suffused in the ultimate ego. No, they meet. And the ultimate ego is as eager to meet the small egos as the small egos are to meet the ultimate. So this is very important, because here both authors meet in their perception of the duality. Whereas Goethe never stopped at that. Goethe remained a seeker all his life. And he, throughout his life, he was a kind of believer, but he didn't know really which shape his beliefs should take. And for most of his life, we would rather describe him as a pantheist. So rather a bit differently from Iqbal. But in this poem, he really shares the same ideas as Iqbal. So finally, I would like to say that the immense differences one sees in the poems must, of course, be attributed to the completely different circumstances under which they were written, and the completely different background. And also, as I said, Goethe was confronted by many dilemmas. He was really feeling very insecure at the time he wrote the poem. He had very many personal dilemmas also. He was not sure whether what his place in life should be. Should he marry, or should he remain free, and also set his creative energies free instead of marrying and getting bound? Or should he follow the career prescribed by his father as a lawyer, or should he rather aspire to something else? So, whereas Iqbal was a much more mature person when he wrote the poem, he had a clear vision. I mean, he knew what he would like the world to be and what he would like to achieve. So that's one more reason, I think, why his poem looks much more classic-y, much more restrained and smooth. But both are very beautiful poems in their own right, but extremely different. So this is as much I would like to go here, and I'm really happy to have any questions or comments from your side. Thank you.